We have pastors who care for the flock, and in their sermons, they take time to speak to our hurts and our sins and our trials and our temptations and our rebellions. And in doing so, Christ speaks to us. Christ speaks to us on Sunday mornings. When a sermon addresses your sin, think, Christ must desire for me to repent of this. When a sermon calls you to practice forgiveness, think, my Lord must desire me to forgive that person. When a sermon calls you to give or to serve or to pray, think, my master must desire for me to do this. When a sermon hurts, think this, the Lord, like a good doctor, must have my good in mind. Don't act as though it's a coincidence that sermons move your hearts. Don't act as a coincidence that they wound your pride and they challenge your way of life and they crush your worldviews. That's what these sermons are supposed to do. Because that is what Christ came to do. And Christ moves through the preaching. We must be people who are sensitive to that. Because harsh words may bruise you for a moment, but they will ultimately, if they are God's words, if they are words of God, they will move you to greater Christ's likeness, which will ultimately be for your joy and your satisfaction in God. My friends, these Sunday mornings with the church gathered are beautiful things. When we come together and we hear the singing and the praying and the preaching and the petitions going up to God, and the Holy Spirit comes and Christ moves through the word and he speaks to us, we must remember that one day Christ will come and he will shake this house. One day Christ will return with a heavenly thunder. He will return and he will not only shake this house, but he will shake the foundations of the earth along with it. No longer meek, no longer mild Jesus, but a returning king, ready to conquer his enemies, ready to bring those who love him into everlasting life. And there will be those who rejoice at the sound of his returning. As we spent Sunday after Sunday hearing the preaching of the word going out, filling our ears, moving our hearts, changing our minds, breaking our worldviews, as we've heard that and as we've opened our Bibles and seen God's glory and goodness, as we read these words and they fill our lives, there will be those of us who rejoice at the sound because we've gorged ourselves. We've gorged ourselves on the voice of God. We've been filled and satisfied by it. We've had steady foretastes of what his voice is going to be like every single day, every single week. His voice will be a familiar and a welcome sound to those who have not turned a deaf ear to the voice of God. Those who wait with bated breath to hear his voice. But there will be those who turn a deaf ear to the word of God. There are those of you right now who are listening to me preach. And as I say, when a preacher preaches, listen, and you're thinking, I don't want to. There will be a day when God returns. Will you be the one who turns to the sky as the trumpet sounds and as lightning flashes and as we see Jesus returning for you, us, will you be one who, like a child longed for his father, raises your hands and says, yes, take me home. I've been waiting for you. I've been longing for you. I've heard your voice. I've waited for it. Will you be one who responds to the king in that way? Or will you be a person who hides in the mountains? Will you be a person who's asking for the mountains to crush you because you've turned a deaf ear to all of the things that the Lord has said? My friends, if there has been no delight in the Lord in this life, there will be no delight for you in the Lord in the next life. So I urge you, turn and repent. Christ is a gentle and merciful Savior.